On this episode of the Bronze Metalist Podcast, we talk about what is perhaps the most influential black metal album of all time, De Mysteriis Dom Sathanas, as a Norwegian person would probably
say.
The Mysteriis of Lord Satan by Mayhem. This will be fun. Hi, everyone. Thank you for tuning in with your 1930s style radio.
Well, hello, everyone.
Hello, yes.
Mr. and Mrs. American, all ships at sea.
To another. This just in, the Lusitania has sunk. That wasn't in the 30s, but who cares? But yes, thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Bronze Metalist Podcast. I'm Kale.
I'm OJ.
And like I said in the intro today, we're going to be talking about Mayhem's debut album, which came out 10 years after the band originally formed.
Right.
We won't talk, I think, too much about the overall story and the controversy around that.
That's been played. That's been said.
Played. Everybody, yeah. Well, not everybody. If you want to know about the whole controversy that led up to the actual release of this album and the murder of Euronymous, Go listen to another podcast or just look it up online for yourself, because it's probably the most told story in the history of metal, pretty much, or at least in the history of extreme metal anyway. So we'll get to the discussion a little bit later. It's been another week and another holiday and another year has gone by. My New Year's was dumb.
Was dumb? You would describe it as being dumb.
Oh, well, I got dumb. I got very dumb.
You got stupid.
I got real stupid. So I was playing a game called Hold Fast Nations at War after I'd finished doing my laundry.
Sure,
For the day. Because, you know what people want to do on New Year's Eve?
Laundry. Yeah.
But it needed to be done, and I was fine. I was like, I'm just going to go do this shit because I'm tired of having dirty clothes. And so I went and used their money changer machine and then realized that when I needed more coins, that their ATM was in a locked part of the building.
Oof.
Because that's, I guess it's kind of smart to have the room where the money machine is locked when people are not there, because the actual part of the business that is, human operated was closed that day, but they still had the laundromat open because it's a laundromat. So yeah, I had to go down the street to one of the banks and use the ATM. And when I got to the ATM, I realized my window wouldn't roll down, so I had to open up my door to use the ATM.
So it was silly.
So that was silly.
Yeah.
Got done doing my laundry, got back here, picked up two bottles of mead because I thought maybe I'll save one for later. I was saving one for later that night.
Yeah, technically you did save it for later.
So like I said, I was playing this game called Hold Fast Nations at War, which is kind of this interesting Napoleonic combat, not simulator, but just shooter. Like a combat simulator would be like Arma or something like that, that goes really, really deep into, you've got compasses and rangefinders and all that shit. This is just, you've got a musket and there are cannons and you're all dressed all silly in bright colors, because that's what you want when people are shooting at you, is bright colors so they can see you. And I was playing that and was having actually quite a bit of fun. Sometimes the chat in that game is no fun at all, because people are just being racist or homophobic or whatever, because it's an online game.
Just toxic people in chat.
Absolute toxic people, and I don't like that at all. It just pisses me off. And the thing is you cannot engage with them, because if you engage with them, it just gets worse. So you just kind of have to ignore them or mute them, but then you end up muting half of your team, and that's just it's bothersome.
It's your team that's the problem.
Yeah, because that's the ones that you can hear, unless you're going up, next to where the other guys are, then you can hear them because there's like a proximity chat in the game. But mostly the ones that I hear are the people that are on my team.
Or the gross, disgusting people that you are in league with.
Because I'm playing on a public server, because I'm not a part of any sort of clan or anything. So I'm playing on a public server, and that sort of thing does happen. It was actually there wasn't really any of that sort of thing on New Year's Eve. So I was actually having a good time.
Sure.
Which led to me drinking vast quantities of mead that would make a Viking blush, and then summarily purging all of that mead that I had drank that night into the garbage can in my studio. So that was, it's over here. I threw it out immediately.
Okay, good. Yeah,
it's not been festering there for a day. No, I immediately took it down and took it down to the dumpster and somehow managed to not eat shit on my way there.
Nice.
Because it's a little icy in the parking lot. But yeah, I took it, threw it out. Not long after that, I decided it perhaps was time to retire for the night. So I went into my bedroom, only to notice that I had not put sheets back on my bed.
Ooh.
And I was really, really drunk and decided I didn't want to try and put sheets on my bed while completely shit-faced. So I just ripped my comforter off of the bed and then went and slept on my couch. I live alone and slept on my own couch. So right now I'm kind of just avoiding alcohol.
Should all acquaintance be that was forgot.
So that was my New Year's Eve. I had, you know, I had so much fun socializing is what I did. I mean, I wasn't completely alone. I had fun with some people that are online that actually didn't piss me off. We were having fun. We were all playing as when we played as the British. You can play as like one of the Highland musketeers or whatever, like Highland troops from Scotland. A bunch of us got together and there was like a whole company of like Scottish Highlanders that where we would march together and
nice.
Try and take objectives while screaming in Scottish accents and
wearing kilts.
And yes, definitely wearing kilts. And we would have bagpipers support us. And other fifers with their tartan and whatnot. So that was a lot of fun. I just, the next day, I paid dearly for all of that fun.
Good thing you didn't have to work.
Yeah, seriously. Well, if I would have had to work, I wouldn't have done that.
You would have called in.
I wouldn't have drank in the first place. Okay. I wouldn't have drank in the first place. I was drinking specifically because I knew I didn't have to work the next day. I just didn't quite plan on getting that shit faced. So, like I said, I'm just avoiding alcohol. So, you kindly brought me some chocolate milk to drink.
I did. I didn't want to show up empty handed.
I do like chocolate milk. Well, once in a while, I'll get the big. Like every once in a while, I'll get the big gallon jugs of chocolate milk because I'm a child. It's so good, though.
Do you pour it into a glass?
Yes, I do.
Okay. So you're a civilized child.
Yes, I'm a civilized child. I pour that shit into a glass. It's just, I don't know. I don't have much of a sweet tooth, but I do love chocolate milk still. How was your New Year's Eve?
Good. My in-laws came down from Canada, and I learned over the last week to use a kitchen mandolin.
Oh yeah,
which means I shredded my hand.
Yeah, you lost a little bit of your body.
Yeah, some flesh. I put some carrots, some pepper, some me into that stir fry.
Hey kids, do you want to know what it's like to be a cannibal? You get just the tiniest little taste of me in there. Taste of OJ.
Mmm. Pulp.
Human pulp. That's not a band name, but I think that's an album name.
It could be
Human
an album
Pulp.
Name.
That
Human
sounds Pulp. Like, honestly, that sounds like a cattle decapitation album name. 2018 came and went. Mm-hmm. Now here we are.
2019. That is crazy.
We're all going to have to start dressing like Blade Runner.
Yeah.
Which I'm fine with because, like, Deckard. He's got a good style. Dusters are coming back.
I think so.
Dusters, they went away, and now their dusters are on their way back.
They go away and come back. They do that. They've been influx, in and out.
So yeah,
like
everybody, everybody get your dusters out, get your like transparent rubber raincoats ready, and we'll be good to go for 2019. We don't have hover cars yet, which is sad.
But you know why all this is cool?
Why?
Because I've seen things
that you people wouldn't believe. Attack ships on fire off the shore. I've got milk and I can't even speak accurately.
You're fine.
I'm fine.
You're fine.
You're damn right I'm fine.
That's
energy
right.
I want to bring into 2019. People just say, you're all right. You're doing fine. It's like, you're damn right I am. That's the energy I want to try and bring into 2019.
You're damn right. I'm not great, but I'm fine.
I'm all right at the very least. and I'd like to do better. That's the energy that I'm going to carry into the next couple of days of 2019 before I forget to have a positive mental attitude.
That is a bumper sticker from hell right there. I'm all right. I'd like to do better.
But I'd like to do better. I mean, self-improvement is fine. That's a good thing to focus on is self-improvement, trying to be a better you. I just, you know, forget about the whole PMA thing very quickly. Like, I'll get into, like, a kick for, like, a day of, like, all right, nothing going to break my stride. And then, oh, something broke my stride. It was a pebble.
It was in my shoe.
That was in my shoe, and I just got annoyed with it, and that's kind of it. But
do you have any resolutions?
Not really. I was thinking about maybe resolving to go to more shows this year.
Ah, okay.
That might be a good thing. I just don't know. Like, one of the big all-ages venues, or at the very least, like, organizers in town has, I guess, shut down. Pangea House was one of the big ones in Minot. And they're, at the very least, not using the space at 62 Doors anymore.
Oh, right.
I don't know when or if they're going to be coming back and where. I do know that there is already, like, a small, like, day festival or whatnot, or at the very least, sort of like a themed concert that is going to be played at 62 Doors, but not as Pangea House.
Sure. Because they have the two stages in there, right?
Yeah. There's one in the back by the kitchen, and then there is, or at least the fridge. Oh, there's an oven there. I'd call it a kitchen. There's an oven and a counter. That's a kitchen. Mm-hmm. And then there's the one in the front in the art space. So... yeah, they had two stages, which was nice. The only time I've actually been to a show there where they utilized both stages was the last show.
The final show.
That where they actually had to utilize both stages. Because the couple I went to before, they only used the one, which I'm not entirely sure why. I don't know if they just didn't have, if like a couple of their speakers were broken or the PA for the other stage wasn't doing its thing. But the last show... It did, and it went pretty well because everybody, you know, you could just go back and forth and set up while the other band is playing. So that was a nice way to do it. So I'm just curious to see what's going to happen with that. But yeah, I'd like to go to more shows. I always say that. Oh, I'd love to go to more shows. And then I see shows happening, and I'm like,
you go,
I don't know if I really want to go to that.
I'm going to stay at home and drink a lot of mead.
Hopefully less of that this year.
So less drinking, is that sort of a...
Yeah, I mean, I've already been doing it for the last couple of months, so sure. I think, I don't know if I want to cut completely, just because I like beer a lot, and I think it's just...
Yeah, me too.
Just after Monday's fiasco, it's like I've been thinking about it a lot lately, and I just don't have fun anymore, especially when I get drunk. It's not fun. I'm always miserable the next day. I'm miserable for the last 2 hours of the getting drunk. So it's like, I don't want that anymore. The next day, I'm terrible with hangovers. Mm. Like, I am absolutely terrible with them, where, like, I will not come out of it. And I will, for the first, like, 3 hours where I really should just be like, all right, go eat some greasy-ass food, drink a ton of water, do all this sort of stuff. I'm just like so in the misery of it that I don't want to do any of those things that I know I should be doing.
Maybe cut out night drinking.
Just switch entirely to day drinking.
Well, okay, actually there's a twilight. There's a period in there. Not day drinking, which is fun always, but also not night drinking. Like,
so
in the evening.
At supper, you mean?
At supper, like seven, like now. Like now, if I mean, obviously you don't feel like it, so don't. I mean,
yeah.
But now would be an appropriate time.
Now.
You have milk now, but I'm saying like milk. You know, after 9 o'clock, you know, switch to chamomile.
switch to my evening tea.
Yeah,
that's okay. Yeah, that's a decent point. Yeah, I don't know. I just did not feel like alcohol. So, do we wanna get into something else that maybe made me a little miserable? A little miserable, not completely.
It made
miserable.
You a little miserable.
I mean, I think that's the point, right? It's black metal. You're supposed to feel miserable.
You're supposed to be a little bit miserable listening to. Although, enervated. I would say enervated is the word that I use.
Enervated? What does that mean?
Like something to get on your nerves. Like something, okay. Something is just on my
something
nerves.
Something about it is bothering you.
I'm holding a glass and I want to break it in my
okay.
hand. And yeah.
It gave you intrusive thoughts.
Yeah.
So, like we said earlier in the episode and in the intro, we listened to De Mysteriis Dom Sathanas, which is dog Latin for, I believe, the mystery of our Lord Satan is what it's supposedly supposed to mean. It's not actual Latin.
No, it's dog Latin.
Which is, unlike pig Latin, where there's like codified rules to pig Latin, dog Latin is just like Warhammer 40K, make up whatever the fuck you feel like. That's dog Latin. Because that's half of the names of everything in Warhammer 40K is right. Just some sort of bastardized fake Latin name. But they can get away with it because they're pretending it's 40,000 years or 38,000 years in the future.
Sure.
So, like, people obviously don't know how to speak Latin anymore. So
no,
that's fine.
It's long dead. Therefore, Therefore, Ferris Menace is fine.
Ferris Menace is absolutely fine. Iron Hands, who had Iron Hands... Primarch of the Iron Hands, who gave themselves Iron Hands in honor of Iron Hands, Iron Hands. We keep on just like waffling away from the album. So briefly about Mayhem. Mayhem is a Norwegian black metal band that began in 1984, was founded by, I was looking up the pronunciation of this because his first name has got the O, but with the dash mark through it.
The U, yes.
It's Ustin. It's supposedly Ustin. Like the I in bird or something like that. Ustin. Erseth, also known as Euronymous, probably the most famous member of the band, even though he's been dead for like a decade and a half.
He was stabbed to death, wasn't he?
Or far more than a decade and a half. Yeah. Like 25 years. He was stabbed, I think, 28 times by Varg Vikernes. Mayhem sort of had a tumultuous history already before they... even put this album out. Actually, most of the tumult of their history happened before this album, which is their debut.
Which is their debut.
They had only sporadic live performances and an EP and a live album that came out before this. They managed to build themselves with that. They managed to build around themselves a cult following of very dedicated fans.
Very dedicated.
And... they were involved in numerous controversies. One of the sort of legendary things is their original vocalist committed suicide. And Euronymous, who is someone that I have a lot of disdain for. And then I'll bring up a point a little bit later that I want to raise to you, as a question that I want to raise to you about Euronymous.
Okay. Famous jeweler, Euronymous.
Famous jeweler, Euronymous. Instead of when he lived with Dead, who was the stage name, his stage name was Dead, was the vocalist.
Yeah.
They lived together, which is probably part of what drove the man to suicide.
Sure.
Because they apparently hated each other. At the very least, it didn't help. Instead of immediately calling the police and saying, oh my God, my roommate killed himself, he went to a store and bought a camera and started taking pictures.
Well, sure.
And rearranged like items around the body. And supposedly, according to the legend, picked up pieces of his skull and used it, made necklaces out of it, and supposedly made a stew out of his brain. I don't believe that part. The necklace part, I think, has been confirmed. So all of this should tell you Euronymous, fucked up guy.
Sure.
The other members of the band, maybe not so much. But Euronymous especially started building this cult of personality around himself that had the ultimate outcome. They set a bar for the black metal community. Like, if Euronymous hadn't done any of this stuff, black metal as it is today would not be, you know, probably nearly as sort of exclusive and weird as it is. I think that's a lot of his influence that we still see today. And that was like the ultimate outcome of this album, is sort of defining what black metal was supposed to be. This album and Mayhem in general is to black metal, I think, what death is to death metal.
Right, yeah.
And the weird thing is like this was happening at around the same time. That, you know, this wave of black metal, there had been earlier waves of black metal in the late 70s and early 80s, and then this was, I guess, the second wave of black metal, and really sort of the one we're still in, as far as the community goes and is concerned.
Because it didn't really go away after this.
Black metal has always kind of still been around in the background, and that's where they want it to be, is in the background. I have my own problems with the exclusivity of the black metal community. I just think it's kind of, it's weird. Because I think, like, ultimately, all the controversy about this album and going into the making of it, was the best marketing they could have possibly asked
for. Oh, sure.
Like, this Mayhem became as close as you can possibly get to a mainstream black metal album.
The Streisand effect.
Yeah, simply because of the controversy. Mm-hmm. And unlike the Streisand effect, which is unwanted attention, I think this was, I wouldn't call it the Streisand effect, because I think the band actually, you know, relished the attention they got, or at the very least Euronymous did before he died. So after he died, after Euronymous died, in 94, around the time that Varg Vikernes was finally being put in jail for a 21-year sentence, which is the maximum in Norway, this album comes out with the surviving members of the band, which is made up of, I believe, the bassist, the drummer, and the new vocalist. They finished it, essentially.
But with still some of the original tracks in there.
Yeah, some. Well, they had Euronymous's parents had requested that when they re-record the album, they get rid of Varg's bass. They didn't do that because the other bassist thought it was interesting to have the victim and the killer on the same album together, which is messed up in its own way, but undeniably interesting. It's still fucked up, but it's interesting. And also very disrespectful to Euronymous's parents.
Well, yeah.
But at any rate, Euronymous's guitar work, I believe that's mostly original recording. That is what is on there. At the very least, he wrote most of the guitar that's on there.
Right.
Although Necro Butcher, who's the bassist, would later claim that he actually wrote like half of the songs or something. Whatever, whoever wrote what, the album came out a full 7 years after they started working on it.
Mm-hmm. Well, they had some issues.
There were some issues in there. But like, it took 7 years for this album to finally come out. I guess for their fans at the time, it seems to have lived up to the hype, because it is still widely regarded as, you know, at the very least, one of the most important black metal albums ever made. And now, me, a person who was born 2 years after it came out, is going to kind of shit on it.
A little bit.
I enjoyed the riffs.
Oh, yeah, the guitar work was great.
The guitar work is good. The atmosphere is good.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the thing about the guitar work, though, is it's good. It's not amazing. I don't know how full of himself as far as a guitarist Euronymous was. It's good and it's atmospheric. But like, reading about the guy, it seemed like he had a sort of a god complex. I don't think that was justified.
No.
He's a decent guitarist.
And it's prototypical work. I mean, it's...
Yeah, it's absolutely prototypical work. It's not... It doesn't blow your socks off. What I wanted to raise to you, speaking of prototypical work, is Euronymous anti-Chuck? Is Euronymous... if Chuck is Santa... Euronymous is...
Krampus?
Yeah. If Chuck is Santa, Euronymous is Krampus.
Okay, I'm down with that.
You're down with that?
Yeah.
Because, like, the guy's personal beliefs were really fucking weird. Like, he was, like, a totalitarian, essentially, where he believed that, you know, freedom was stupid and all humans should be made slaves or some bullshit. And, like, he had some really wacky personal politics that I disagree with vehemently, but... Like I said, he's the anti-Chuck, because Chuck, who is also, you know, one of the founders of a very influential genre of metal, is the complete opposite type of person, where he loved people and life and freedom and all that. Like Chuck was the absolute opposite.
And puppies and...
I'll stop talking about Euronymous in a second, because I said I wasn't going to do this, but like...
But you've already done it. It's too late.
I've already done it. You can't... We've just proved that you cannot talk about Mayhem without talking about the controversy.
Right.
One of the things that he really espoused was how much he hated Swedish death metal.
Okay.
Because or even Norwegian death metal. He thought that Swedish and Norwegian death metal of the late 80s and early 90s was too commercial. Swedish and Norwegian death metal is too commercial. Mm-hmm. Are you fucking kidding? He was, to me, what I in high school would have called a try hard.
Yeah.
He's trying way too fucking hard to be cool, and like, man had a lot of problems.
And so none short of which were 28 stab wounds. I mean,
Those were perhaps the most significant problems in the last few minutes of his life. I suppose if we want to talk a little bit more about the history of the band, we can't talk about Mayhem without talking about their connection to the church burnings
in 1991.
That's probably what they're most famous for, mm-hmm. and what black metal in general is most famous for. There was a series of church burnings throughout Norway, and I think maybe a little bit of Sweden. I can't remember if there were any
across Scandinavia.
Yeah, across Scandinavia, fans of Mayhem began to, or at the very least, you know, fans, people associated in that community began to burn down churches, specifically stave churches, which mm-hmm. we have one of those here in Minot.
We do.
Or at least a replica stave church. I know, don't they do weddings in there occasionally?
They do.
So they're beautiful buildings. Mm-hmm. I think they're absolutely gorgeous. So they started burning down a bunch of those. Varg was heavily involved in that, as I understand. His involvement ended when he went to prison.
But Varg is out of prison now, though.
Yes, he is. He got a 21-year sentence, which is the maximum in Norway. He's been out since 2004 or 5, because he was sentenced in 94, I think. So, yeah, he got out around 2004, 2005.
So he got a commuted sentence, or what is he?
Oh, maybe he did get a commuted sentence. Because, yeah, it was like 2005, I think.
I'm just doing math here.
Yeah, no, you're right. Let me look at his Wikipedia page to see if he got a commuted sentence. He was released on parole in early 2009, so he got paroled, is what happened. And he's been making
Still making music. Yeah,
he's still making. He was making music the whole time he was in prison too.
Right.
And it's like pagan, sort of neo-Nazi stuff, because that is a whole nother topic about black metal. That's a whole nother element of the community. It's sort of the same thing with paganism, where there is a sharp divide in black metal and like the neo-pagan community between people that are okay and are just fine,
mm-hmm.
and just kind of have, you know, they like to, we believe in the old Norse gods, that's fine. And people who like black metal, it's just, they like the music and the atmosphere.
Because it's fun. And
then people
artistic.
Who use the communities of both of those and the isolation of those communities to promote like neo-Nazi ideals and that sort of thing. Sort of the idea of the exclusivity of black metal, and then the history, the ethnic history combined with like mm-hmm. Germanic paganism is the big thing for the, this is a white person's religion.
That,
is their
white
whole
person's
thing.
Music. This is Teutonic.
Yeah. So there's a very sharp divide in both of those communities between like the neo-Nazi half and the normal people half who are pleasant and good to be around
mm-hmm.
and not assholes. So yeah, now we got to talk about the album itself now.
All right.
So you had heard a little bit of this before.
I had heard this before.
But you hadn't listened to it all the way through.
No.
This was also my first complete listen through.
Mm-hmm.
I had listened to a couple snippets, I think, over the summer, because I was just interested. It was like almost like morbid curiosity. I was just like, let's see what this actually sounds like. Oh God, that's not really, not really my thing.
Not my cup of tea.
Sat down and listened through it. What was your favorite track on this album?
I liked the opening track.
Okay.
I enjoyed the guitar work. I enjoyed the what did I enjoy about it?
Yeah, no, I don't blame you for that.
Yeah,
if you can't nail it down, I'll follow up with my favorite. I liked Buried by Time and Dust.
Sure.
Simply because it's the shortest song on the album. It is also it is also by far the closest sounding song on the album to like death metal.
Sure.
And I think it's also the best vocal performance by Attila Sihar, I think is the way you pronounce his last name. Sihar or whatever is the vocalist that replaced Dead.
Right. Now some of Dead's tracks are on here, right?
I think they released another version, or it's all his lyrics, but I think all of the vocals on here are Attila.
Okay.
There is a different release of some sort that did have some of Dead's tracks on it, though. I can't remember off the top of my head what that was, but I think you can find some of Dead's tracks from this record somewhere in their discography.
But not in wide release.
Yeah, it's like a specialty thing, I think. I don't know if it's available on streaming platforms or not, but as far as I know, all of the tracks on the studio release of the record is Attila. And like the band that shares his name, not a huge fan.
Not a huge fan.
Like his performance on Buried by Time and Dust is like comparable to what I would say are some of the worst and least skilled vocalists in death metal.
Right.
Where it's just kind of grunting. Like there's very little consistency. There's very little punch or power, I guess. Like they're not I would call most death growls thick.
Sure.
Essentially, where you've got, you know, thick vocal fry and you can mm-hmm. hear sort of the vibrations and the violent, you know, vibrations of the vocal cords and that sure. sort of thing. This was like this.
And it sounded a little accidental.
Yeah. Like maybe he didn't mean to do it that way.
Yeah, like you know, for me it sounded a lot like if a young Dave Mustaine was really, really, really drunk and high. And couldn't articulate.
Just, yeah. To Attila's defense, maybe, or mm-hmm. credit, he is English is probably his third language.
Sure.
I don't know how much Norwegian he even knew at the time. He's Hungarian originally. So he was a, you know, Hungarian vocalist singing lyrics written by a dead Swede in English.
Dead Norsky.
Well, I think Dead was Swedish.
Dead was Swedish?
I'm pretty sure Dead was Swedish. But he was singing, you know, those lyrics, singing. He was singing. Because some of it is attempting to be melodic. On the last track, he does this sort of operatic vocal, which is just the silliest shit. It's so silly.
So silly. You know, but I mean, it's so weird. I mean, it's so historically important and bizarre at the same time.
And I will say, his vocals do add to the atmosphere. Like, it adds another level of bizarreness to mm-hmm. the atmosphere of the record, which it helps it a little bit. I don't know if it really hurts it all that much. I think it's... I would prefer to hear this album with traditional black metal style vocals on mm-hmm. it, like something that you would hear from like Gorgoroth or something like that, where it's traditional sort of the high scream or something like that.
Right.
Or... Even like, I think Gorgoroth's last album, they went to just doing straight up death growls instead over traditional, you know, tremolo picked black metal guitars and that sort of thing. Like, I would love to hear this album with a better vocalist is what I'm saying. I can't bring myself to like anything about the vocal performance. Like at best, he's still a bad version of a like good death metal vocals. And apparently he's gotten better since then. I haven't listened to their recent work. There's I think one of their albums from like the early 2000s or something like that where people said apparently his vocals were praised on that. But
nice.
And I think we're far from the first people to shit on Attila's vocals. In a review, I can't remember the name of the website, but they called him Attila Fingernails Sihar.
Fingernails on the chalkboard.
Yeah, fingernails on the chalkboard. Let me look at what website that was. Metalreviews.com, which is just a very generic name for a website, but might have been, you know, from late 90s or something like that when you could have very generic
sure.
website names like that. Yeah, they called him Attila Fingernails Sihar, which is, I think, appropriate. I think that's appropriate for his vocal style.
Because it seems like maybe he wasn't given any cues.
Yeah, or just... Like, it just seems like he's not trying. I can't figure out if he needs to be putting more force into his voice or less force into his voice. I don't know what the problem is. I don't know if he's just, like, overpowering his vocal cords so much that all is coming out is this grunt, or if he's just putting so little effort into it that he's just kind of talking like this. Yeah, he growls like an animal a couple times.
Yeah, you know, and it's funny because I played this for my wife briefly.
Your poor wife.
Yeah, and I said, well, you know, this part right here comes off as being kind of silly, and she said, I can't understand the words. What's silly about it? And then
There are no words.
No, you don't understand. I don't know what the words are either. It's just, it just sounds silly.
I'm
so
normally
like,
good
yeah,
at,
it's a given.
I'm normally good at this shit.
Yeah. I'm normally great at this, but.
Yeah. He seems to also finish every line of lyrical content with the same, like, inflection. Mm-hmm. Like, it all ends on a. Fuck. Like it all sounds like that. That's the way he delivers every line. And I don't get how they took 7 years to make this and didn't spend a little bit more time. But that's the black metal ethos in a nutshell right there, though, isn't it? Because part of the whole thing of the underground black metal scene, at least, is record it on your old Nokia and put it on Bandcamp or whatever.
Sure.
Or put it, take it, somehow take it from your old Nokia straight to vinyl or straight to, you know, record it. Not even, don't transfer the file to something that can put it on a tape.
Well, they
don't transfer the file.
Before that was a thing, but before there was a file.
But that's
system.
Absolutely, I think that's what bands do now.
Yeah.
But like record it on your old Nokia and then grab a microphone and hold it up to the speaker, and that's how you put it on your tape or whatever. Like the lo-fi thing. I think the lo-fi recordings from metal it's sort of divisive for me because sometimes it's like I completely understand why somebody wants to go with a lo-fi sound. It adds a lot of warmth to it. It can add like thickness to a recording, essentially, where it's, you know, the tracks might sound bare without it. You know, you kind of have the disparity between like underground death metal bands with sort of very warm, fuzzy recordings, and then you've got like technical death metal bands where it's hyper processed and super precise.
Because it needs to be. Yeah.
And like black metal has sort of settled on this idea that lo-fi is what we do. There are high fidelity black metal bands out there, and those tend to be the ones that I like.
Mm-hmm.
The one that I'm bringing next week is...
Who's that?
That is Kralis.
Oh, okay.
I'm trying to remember the specific album. I'll text it to you because I can't remember it off the top of my head.
Okay.
But there is a band called Kralis. They're an American black metal band. I think they're American anyway. And their recording is pretty decently high quality. I enjoy it quite a bit more than what we listened to today. And I think you can still find like elements of what Mayhem did, because that is the ultimate legacy of this album. I feel like this album is almost entirely about the legacy and just the legacy of the band, because when any metalhead hears the word Mayhem,
mm-hmm.
you don't think of the songs, you think of the story. Like people, black metal is sort of one of those things where you kind of either love it or hate it. I think there's a lot of people who listen to metal who listen to the vast majority of different types of metal. Like myself, for example, I like death metal. Mm-hmm. I don't mind thrash metal. I'm getting more and more into it. I've, you know, ventured a little bit into like sludge and stoner metal type stuff. Like I'm sort of spreading my wings, and there's a lot of it I like. But then you get to like the really lo-fi black metal stuff, and I can't bring myself to like it. It's too much.
Then there's the high fidelity stuff like Dimmu Borgir.
Yeah, Dimmu Borgir, the new Gorgoroth, or like Kralis, or that sort of thing. I enjoy that because they're not so far up their own asses.
We're making a production. We're doing something for the public, the crowd, our fans, not just something because we want to be artists.
Like it's or because it's you know the. The darker it sounds, the more you praise Satan or whatever the fuck. I don't know. That is the other thing. It's like, I don't know how much of Mayhem's reputation, other than obviously the deaths and the church burnings, how much of Mayhem's reputation, especially the Satanism, was serious and how much of it was artifice or like kayfabe from wrestling. Or kayfabe, or however you say it.
Kayfabe.
Like how much of that was just a front that they put up to attract the right crowd for their music. I don't know.
Who knows?
Like, I think Euronymous is the only one who knew, and he did.
He did.
I tell you, he did. Very dead, indeed.
Yeah.
Speak a little bit more about the incident of his death, because Varg drove, like, several hours specifically to go to Euronymous's house.
And murder him.
Yeah. He claims that was not the case. I can't remember why he said he went over to Euronymous's house. I think it was he owed him money or something like that. But he went to Euronymous's house and stabbed him again upwards of 20 times, including several times in the head. Varg claims it was self-defense. I don't know about you, but if I'm defending myself with a knife, not only do I not stab someone 20 plus times, I also don't stab them in the head.
Right. You stab them in the torso somewhere.
Yeah, because hopefully you're hoping not to kill that person.
Hey, you're just trying to get away.
Yeah, you're just trying to incapacitate them so you can get away and get out of that situation. You don't stab them 20 plus times, including several in the head.
And then I shot him 8 times with a bolt action rifle. And he kept coming at me.
It just kept going.
And then I had my flamethrower.
Oh, okay, calm down, Pat from Cannibal Corpse. With your flamethrowers.
Any news on that story, by the way?
I think it got released on bail. But I do believe they said that there were skulls found in his house and upwards of 80 firearms.
Okay.
Which, I love guns. 80, unless you're like a sort of academic collector of firearms, I think you'll find gun nuts in, at least in this state, that will tell you 80 might be too much.
That's a bit high.
How do you maintain 80 firearms? Like, that's got to be annoying, especially when you live in fucking Florida. That's terrible. If you like, I've always heard if you want to collect firearms, move to Arizona because the laws are a little bit more favorable for that sort of thing. And also, it's way easier to maintain them because the air is not trying to turn your weapon into rust.
Sure.
So I don't know how he not only purchased 80 firearms on a guitarist's pay rate, but also managed to have time to.
Well, I have to assume he had a climate controlled room, because maybe as a guitarist, I can say that having a climate controlled room is a really good thing.
Maybe they go hand in hand.
Maybe he had all his guns and guitars together.
that could very well be. We're unraveling the mystery. Yeah, I think that's about all I knew.
And that's where you keep your skulls as well.
That's also where you keep your skulls.
Uh-huh.
I'm trying to remember if that was actually true or if that was a not a sensationalist headline, but like a fake news or like a meme type headline. I can't remember. I think they did actually find skulls. I can't confirm that as of now. Look it up for yourself. I think the firearms thing is definitely true, though. And also military-grade flamethrowers.
Sure. That much we were pretty much positive.
Something exploded. So, yeah, that was a weird situation. I think we're done. We're done definitely talking about Mayhem today. Just like Mayhem, there are so many bands. There are so many classic bands that maybe I have a little bit of trouble getting into because, it feels like I've heard it before. The same reason why people say these days that Seinfeld isn't funny.
Sure.
Because if you've grown up watching sitcoms and you're around my age, you've basically seen 15 different shows that are ripping off of Seinfeld. And so you feel like you've heard all of the jokes before.
Mm. Like when somebody says, I don't know if I care for Venom. Oh, come on.
Or it's like I don't know how much I can really get into. I can really get into to Metallica.
Yeah,
that's a little bit how I feel. It's like I don't know. Metallica isn't relevant to me, typically speaking,
because you're too young.
Yeah, and most of those I feel bad about because it's like I feel like as a metalhead, you know, I'm not into the whole gatekeeping thing where it's like if you want to do this, you have to do that.
No,
I think that's stupid. You know, do whatever you like, but there is still a feeling of like, how can I really call myself a fan of metal music if I don't listen to these and enjoy them? I feel like I'm obligated to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Mayhem, on the other hand,
it's hard.
it's hard. I do not feel much obligation at all to actually enjoy Mayhem or to listen to more of their... I'm curious about the rest of their discography to hear how their sound is developed and to hear if Attila is still fucking atrocious. Because there's a lot of other black metal vocalists that I think are fine.
Mm-hmm. That are great, yeah.
Yeah, and that are good and that like do more traditional, like harsh vocals and that sort of thing. Like I appreciate that just fine. It's some of the community is what bothers me, but the
music itself.
The music itself is all right.
Yep.
And Mayhem is like the exception of that where it's like, I don't feel like I need to listen to more Mayhem. I feel like this is kind of enough. It, like I said earlier, it's sort of a morbid curiosity. Mm-hmm. It's like, is this really as bad as I think it is?
It's not bad. I'm not gonna say it's bad.
I wouldn't say that either. I think if you are a fan of atmosphere, you'll like this because that's what I appreciated the most about it. This album definitely sells the atmosphere. It nails it. And I don't think Attila's vocals detract from that. It's just as someone who is used to vocals that had more work and or skill put into them.
He'd be great if he just had the work, the skill, and the talent. Yeah. If he just had those things,
if he were only talented. Oh, honey, you'd be so great if you had any talent. Say that to a kid. Crush their dreams.
I think I have. I have five kids.
You probably said it to one of them at some point.
At some point. Well,
sorry,
you'd be
you
great.
Just have no talent.
You'd be dangerous if you had talent.
That's how I felt about when I tried to play basketball when I was in junior high.
Sure, you were tall, like, I'm sure.
Not really, no. I was not tall in junior high. Actually, there was a lot of tall guys in my class. Mm. For a while, I was like the second or third shortest guy.
Really?
Because I think my growth spurt kind of came late compared to everyone else. Because there are like four or five guys in my high school class that were above 6 foot, or at least were 6 foot or above. But yeah, how I felt about basketball was, man, I'd be so good at this if I had any talent whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Even back then, before I started gaining weight, not that I'm particularly fat or anything, but like even back then when I was young and skinny, I was not very athletic. So
my problem doing basketball, because I did basketball in like the fourth grade. And I realized that team sports are not the best for me because I don't like rooms with other people in them.
Oh yeah.
I don't really play teams very well.
I suppose that would help if you want to. I don't really feel like being in this room with all of these people.
Yeah, I don't really want to be here.
But putting this ball in this hoop would be fine if all of you were gone.
Yeah. I can play a game of solo horse. I could do
also,
that.
Also, otherwise known as just solo basketball practice. So before we wrap up, I don't know if this is something that occasionally we want to do in a more structured manner. I feel like structure is an important thing for 2019 that we want to try and get into is some form of structure for these podcasts. So movie wrap-up / recommendation. Because sometimes I'll watch movies that I like and I feel like talking about
them.
We
all love movies.
I watched another Lynn Ramsey movie.
Did you really?
Which is We Need to Talk About Kevin.
Oh, sure.
And it was haunting. I think that's the most succinct word for it is haunting. It's got Tilda Swinton and Ezra Miller as alongside a very good dramatic performance from... Shit. Dr. Steve Brule. What's his name? Oh, no. John C. Reilly.
John C. Reilly, yeah.
I'm John C. Reilly. Yeah, hi, everybody.
We got these bunk beds. We're going to have so much room for activities.
A good dramatic performance from John C. Reilly, because that's the fun thing about John C. Reilly is every once in a while you remember that he's actually like a serious dramatic actor.
Right.
And that's how he got his start in Hollywood. And it's about a mother who is dealing with the fallout of a heinous act that was committed by her son, Kevin, and sort of thinking about his childhood and all of her experiences with him and trying to decipher how he came to be the person he is, because evil is probably the best way to describe the character of Kevin. So it is a haunting movie, I think, especially for a lot of the events that have been happening relating to violence.
The movements that we're in at the moment.
Yeah, violence in schools, particularly in the United States. I think that it has some interesting points or things to say about it, sort of exploring how does somebody grow up to become... Well, he wasn't a shooter in the movie. I don't want to spoil it necessarily, but how does someone grow up to commit a massacre at a school? And, you know, what sort of person they might be. Very good. Very good movie. I enjoyed it quite a bit.
Well, I tend to like Ann Ramsey movies.
Lynn Ramsey, you mean? Oh,
Ann Ramsey. Oh, you mean did like this,
you did this
the
last.
Train.
You did this last time.
Yeah, sorry.
It's okay. I did watch Ann Ramsey is the lady from Goosebumps, right? Not Goosebumps.
No, from
Goonies.
Goonies.
God damn it.
Right.
The lady from Goonies.
R.L. Stine. Yeah.
Yeah. Ann Ramsey, a.k.a. R.L. Stine. I did watch Goonies.
Did you?
Over Christmas. Mm-hmm. I watched Goonies. I like Goonies.
It's a good movie.
So that concludes the movie part of the podcast. That's all we have to say about Goonies. Two recommendations. Goonies and we need to talk about Kevin.
Both Ann Ramsey movies.
Both involve women named Ramsey.
Yeah.
Sure. There was also a great parody that I saw called We Need to Talk About Kevin McAllister.
Which, that was a funny video.
That was a hilarious video. So, yeah, about time for us to wrap this up.
Mm-hmm.
As is usual, I'm going to plug our social media at the end of the episode. We're on Twitter. We're on Facebook. We are on Instagram. I keep on saying I need to post pictures there. Just, you know.
You're behind on it.
I'm behind. I don't know what to post pictures of on Instagram is the thing.
Nudes.
Yeah.
You want to put
nudes
up. Well,
you can't do that.
Is that against policy?
That is against policy. They do not allow. They do not allow.
So no nudes.
They do not allow genitalia or female presenting nipples. I think male nipples are fine.
If you want to see us not naked on.
If you want to see me fully clothed, you can go to Instagram. That's all you'll ever see. That's all you should ever want to see. This is my body's a real pile of garbage.
Dude.
Sorry. PMA.
PMA, man.
PMA, man. Positive mental attitude. I'm a feel better about myself in 2019. So yeah, you can go on Instagram and find some pictures that occasionally I post. I think the last one was when I got the first computer that didn't work that I sent back.
Sure.
So if you want to see a picture of what my setup looks like, there you go. I don't know why I became sassy there at the end.
So sassy.
So sassy. Other things that you can do. Well, the things that you want to do on our social media is share our posts with your buddies, especially when we're posting links to episodes. Share that stuff with your friends. If your friends like metal, if they're curious about metal, just tell them to give us a try.
Are they metal curious?
Are they metal curious? Tell them to explore their musical preferences. It's 2019. It's 2019. We need to all be okay with exploring our musical preferences. All right?
There's nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with that.
And remember, if you want to pay somebody to... If you want to pay us to talk about it, I want to get this done.
Okay.
I want somebody to give us a
dollar.
You
can keep promoting it, because I'm done promoting it. You can keep on promoting it if you
we'll
want.
We'll talk about you. We'll talk about your business.
Yeah. Hey, businesses. Do you want to do a sponsorship on this for whatever reason? Sure.
We're good at that. We know how to do it.
Well, that is true. We're professionals. Yeah. We do know how to do that shit.
True that.
So, with that out of the way, I'd like to thank you all very much for listening to another episode of the Bronze Metalist Podcast. I'm Kale.
I'm OJ.
Congratulations.